Today we have Shiriz with us, and she is going to speak with us about her passion and about her purpose. So, Shiriz is a very dynamic live vocalist, recording artist, and songwriter, experienced vocal coach, and she is also EQ certified coach. Shiriz is voiceover artist, she is marathon runner, and she is also technical writer. Oh my God! And she's beautiful, intelligent, contented soul. So Shiriz, you are here with us today. And welcoming you all again in our talk show, the Mindful Heart Talk Show. A call for mindfulness, that is passion, profession and purpose. Yes. Great. So Shiriz,
thank you so much, Aarti, for that beautiful introduction. I did not expect so much positivity from you and for so many great adjectives, but thank you. I'm feeling very humbled by what you just said.
Of course, you deserve it. You have done so many things in your life. So let's begin. So Shiriz, how is your pandemic time going on?
Well, this pandemic, it has taught me a lot. I mean, it started off, and you know, when we all started with this lockdown period, we didn't know, you know, how it's going to be, how this whole period is going to be, how long it's going to last, how we are going to manage. There were a lot of unknowns, and a lot of us have had to deal with so many factors, external as well as internal. External being, you know, the availability of work, like how people will react when they don't see us, me as an artist, as a performing artist, how my fans will react when they don't see me performing anymore, how am I going to carry on my passions and my work from home. So there are a lot of things that we needed to solve, a lot of challenges. So as time went on, we got certain answers as to how to deal with the situation. And I spoke about external and internal. Internal being like, you know, my self-confidence levels, like, you know, my self-worth. How do I define my self-worth in such a period?
Actually, I mean, the same question that, you know, as a performer, how do you feel when programs are not happening right now?
Right. So there are a lot of questions that happen internally. What am I going to do? Who am I now? This time, I don't have the power to, to sing. I mean, how will I do it from home? And how am I going to earn? And how am I going to carry on what I need to carry on from home? And suppose I get bored, what am I going to do? They see it. An idle mind is the devil's workshop. So I wanted to avoid that idle mind syndrome. So I just still wanted to continue being the positive person that I've always been, even in any situation. So such tough times, that, you know, it calls for a lot of adjustment and flexibility. And the entire world is going through this, and there are certain, you know, people who take it positively and certain people who like take it negatively, like for example the spread of fake news and stuff. That's a very negative thing to do. So instead, like people like us who have, you know, have been privileged to understand how to be positive and how to help others to be positive, and you know, we understand how important it is to be kind to each other. So, you know, people like me, I feel that I have the responsibility to spread that kindness and that joy during such terrible times. If you remember the movie Titanic, yes. Of course, I've seen it a lot of times, that movie. It's one of my favorite movies. As the ship was about to sink, it was going down, there were people, you know, running helter-skelter, trying to save themselves, trying to save their families. But there were also this group of artists and musicians who were there on the ship, and they kept on playing music even though they got nothing from it. Everyone was panicking, but they kept on playing their violins, and they said that, you know, we are going to play music and we're going to entertain people till we die. So I really liked their attitude, and by watching them, I kind of related myself in this situation to them, that, you know, we continue doing positive things till we die, and that's going to make a difference to the environment around us. That's what I truly believe in.
I really love the navigation of your emotion and also the example. Tell me something about your passion and how did you decide to become a singer? And have you left your IT behind completely or you are still managing with it and balancing both the activities together?
So, to your first question about how I realized that I need to get into music, I would say this idea of me getting into music, it's been ingrained in me since a child. Like, I always loved to sing. When I was a baby, when parents took me to the doctor to get vaccinated, to get an injection. So that time, my parents told me this story, that when I saw the doctor, I started crying and I was scared. But as soon as there was music playing in the rickshaw that they were taking me in, they were taking me in a rickshaw to the doctor. So as soon as the rickshaw started playing music, then I stopped crying. So from that story, I realized that maybe, since child, I always had this inclination towards music, and music always made me happier as a person. And since it has done so much for me, I should be a medium for that, to do that to others. So to have that positive effect on others. So if music can make someone, a baby who is crying, stop crying, I'm sure it can do a lot for adults as well, that, it will calm people down. And I also feel a lot of, life is all full of vibration and energy. Whenever we speak, whenever we breathe, or the way we are, the way I am, I feel like I'm a vibration. Remember when I'm speaking, or even when the earth is moving, it's generating some sound or some vibration. It has some effect or the other on our conscious and our subconscious mind. So I just wanted to, even whether we like it or not, we are part of this, collective vibration. And at some point we all meet and we are all, parallelly vibrating together. So it's for me, generally speaking, I love to be a positive vibration for others wherever I am. So that's that. And with regards to, the IT and the other things that I've picked up along the way, I just feel that it's good to keep learning different things, but because we don't know when it's going to come in use. For example, recently someone tried to hack my Instagram account, and they tried to do something, but then I realized since I know IT, I can, stop this thing from happening because I have this skill. So I know ethical hacking and stuff, so because I learned all this, I'm able to use that skill to be able to spot when people are trying to take advantage of me, even commerce. I mean, when I've learned even accounting, so it helps me when I'm running my music business, and when I'm negotiating, my knowledge of commerce helps me to, and finance, it helps me to deal with all the financial aspects. So because of that, I don't need to depend on anyone. I don't need to hire an accountant to handle my money issues. So basically, whatever we learn in life, even right from childhood till now, it does come in use, sometime or the other. Even things like theorems or in school, why did we learn Pythagoras theorem or derivatives or integration? At some point of time, it comes in use, even probability. So yeah, I always feel like we need to keep updating ourselves in skills and knowledge. I have so much more to learn, especially in music and stuff like that, theory. I don't say I'm perfect. My growth, and I've been blessed with that ability to pick up things very quickly. Thank God for that. And that's why I'm able to move forward with that belief and that attitude towards learning.
Shiriz, what I really liked from your discussion, that you are an MBA also, you are graduated from, you are a computer science graduate and computer engineering, right?
Yes, sir. That's right. I did my BSc IT, which is, it was 3 years, it's equivalent to engineering. But because I did my 12th in commerce, I could not get into engineering, though I wanted to. So according to the university rules, I could take up BSc IT, which has the same subjects, since from second year engineering till fourth, the subjects are the same. So I majored in software and web development.
Yes, that's fantastic. Yeah. So the important part is that you are graduated from computer science. That's what.
Right, right.
And also you are an MBA, post-grad graduation. So, and also you are a singer and you are so passionate singing. So this is like kind of a wholesome project that you know the finance, you know the, you know your computer graphics, you know how to deal with all these problems. Like if someone hacks someone, you know, something happens with your page or something like that. And also you know the business. So this is very important. And you know, this is a business. That's why you are also somewhere, I feel, you are mentally prepared to hear a negative answer from other side.
Right.
That is really, that is in this particular entertainment industry. I think that is very important. So my next question for you is the same related with our discussion only. That how do you keep your mental health in check while working with your art form?
Well, that's a very loaded question. I mean, it's very relevant as well to the current situation where a lot of artists are having to move through this times when we have less work, you know, compared to when we were so busy. This thing, you know, it brings out whatever you're going through internally. It comes out, you know, in some way when we communicate, when we talk to others, all our thoughts, it comes out in some way or the other. So it's very important to take care of our inner being and our inner peace of mind. You know, that because that is going to come through when we are communicating. And being an artist is being a communicator. Like even a painter, the way he paints and uses the colors and stuff, it comes out in the way he or she would paint his or her mental state of being. So it's having said that, it's actually quite you know, it's quite difficult and quite easy also, because being in this art form, I've realized, you know, being into music, I've realized sometimes certain small things, that small adjustments that we make, it makes a big difference. In suppose I'm singing a song, a small adjustment, for example, taking a breath in the middle of before the start of a verse, that changes the sound. So even in terms of mental health, sometimes it does not take a big step. It's just basically saying to yourself that I know that I am good. You're telling yourself that, you know, like what people are telling you is not the real truth. You know what your truth is. You know your own growth, and you know, basically just loving yourself being true to your own truth and your own life, your own journey, knowing your own journey, that helps to battle depression, number one. And number two, it also gives you a better vision for your own future. Like like whenever I feel sad and whenever I feel down, I just write down my thoughts, because a lot of things are going through my mind at that time. And it can lead to a good place or a bad place. You know, I think that road, it's a very dark road when you're feeling like when someone, you know, someone tells you that you're worthless, or someone tells me that, oh, the content that you put is really bad. And, you know, it can do something, it can affect a person. So whenever I feel that way, I go inward and I accept. First step is to accept that maybe whatever that person is saying, there is some 5% truth in that, maybe. But you know, 85%, it could have been that they could have put it in a better way, but they did not. But it's up to me to do that, because they may not have had that ability to make it a very good sandwich feedback. But it's up to me to accept that maybe I did a mistake, but I can learn from this mistake. I can, the next time I put out something, the next time I go on stage, I can, you know, tell myself I will be a better person. And also it comes from the fact that, okay, this thing does not make me happy. You know, this is not the only thing that makes me happy. I have so many other blessings in life that make me happy, like my family, my friends. I have people to turn to talk to, and I can find some way or the other to make myself happy again. So, for example, if someone is in love with someone else and they don't love them back, you can't control someone, and you can't expect someone that you love to love you back. Now, what do you do in that situation when you know for years you love that person and they don't love you back? So it's just realizing that person does not control your state of being.
Mm.
So, I mean, others will say, okay, there are a lot of fish in the sea, but you realize that, okay, that person was actually meant for me, but that person does not realize that. But in order to fill up that void from being lonely, and I realize a lot of youth nowadays are very lonely in their life, and they're not able to reach out to someone who they have a crush on or they like. So it's finding that love within yourself, that you are able to love, to give so much of love to people. So why not do it in some other way? You know, you divert that love and that positivity in some other medium, so that in that medium you will get the appreciation that you need. For example, if you have written a poem for the person that you love, why not write a poem for your parents? You know, they will appreciate it so much better than the person who you were directing it to and they did not give it to you back. So it's basically that particular feeling that you have for something or someone. If you're not getting that back from that thing, you can direct it somewhere else and, you know, get that same acknowledgement that you were expecting from that other thing, instead of directing it in somewhere where you're not getting that. So I've realized that's one lesson I've learned in life.
Amazing. I really like the idea that you should not keep that feeling which is constantly erupting in your mind again and again, and which is making you depressed or making you feel lonely. You should actually reach out or vent out that feeling with some constructive way. So,
right.
I really like that particular point, and I really want to, repeat that point. I already repeated. So it's amazing to see you doing that constantly in your life. Whenever I know there are very less number of times you have to face these kind of things, but whenever you might have faced, you are actually applying it and again coming back, again becoming, you know, stronger and balanced and started your work. And it's amazing. It's really amazing.